I need so to stay in your arms, see you smile, hold you close.
There is also a haunting refrain from the tragedies in Matthew's life. The death of his father from cancer when Matthew was only 10, and the shooting death of his older sister in a domestic dispute.
I was just wondering if you'd come along.
I think one of the things that we mourn when people die, whether or not we bring it to the forefront, is our loneliness. Is, you know, because it's suddenly upon us, you know, when I don't think I'd ever felt that sense of loneliness up until the point that my father died. I think when my dad died, there was, even though the family was together and we were, you know, sitting on a bed, weeping together when everyone heard about it, was that all of us had this sudden, real perspective of how lonely life is.
And your sister, because it's so different. Is it different when it's, dramatic and stolen? And
there's a lot more anger that came with her death, a lot more disbelief that came with her death. My hopes for music vanished. My hopes for happiness vanished. So just all right at that moment, my want for my next meal vanished. My concern about anyone but me and my family vanished, you know, just immediately, because what now is important is our little group, our little troop of monkeys is all that matters now. And we have to get together and try and make sense of the emptiness, you know.
Someone said, I think, life is unfair, you know, but it doesn't make it any more comprehensible or any more able to.
No. I remember this was something that really, really upset me after my sister died, was people coming up, even though the intention was so good, people coming up and saying, you know, God has a plan. And I was always like, well, I'm not too fond of his plan. And right now, if I bumped into him, I'd probably have a few things to say to him. That's one of the things that makes me think, no, I don't think God is that precise. Because if it is that precise, it's very fickle. And if the source of the universe is that fickle, boy, it's got two different personalities. Boy, it's got, that it could be so trite and so vindictive. I'm not really interested in that that power.
Now this creeping suspicion that things here are not as they seem.
Matthews would sit alone in his room inventing complex songs with unconventional rhythms. After working up the courage to play for the other musicians who would form the band, his repertoire consisted of only 4 original songs.
Praying for some way to show them I'm not what they see.
But what the band did with them was something else. For Dave Matthews, the union was the culmination of a dream.
The step for me between being a professional musician and being just a dreamer, you know, fantasizing about what it would be like to be in front of an audience, the switch was pretty sudden. I mean, I'd all my life loved playing the guitar and for years had loved writing songs, little folk songs, but never really thought that it was real. But I can remember the first time I saw Carter and the times following that, and the first time I saw Leroy, and the many times after that. And thinking how much I loved them, and I think that in a certain way my passion for music was inspired by them and other people. But when I finally started performing with Leroy and Carter and Stefan, that switch happened almost without me knowing it. You know, I was apprehensive, and you know, because these are sort of heroes of mine, to be performing with them. But then, really, it had a year had passed, and we were starting to get some sort of recognition in the Southeast. And when I turned around and said, "Wow, I'm actually doing something that I spent the last 15 years just fantasizing about."
Playing at a local club, they caught the ear of club owner and now their manager, Coran Capshaw.
I didn't pay much attention the first night they were playing there. I noticed there were a good number of people there for the first time. Second time they played there, I started really looking at the band. I said, you know, this is a pretty special band here.
What did they have?
They just had a different sound, and they played great live. They're the best, and I've seen a lot of bands and seen a lot of music. They're the best live band that I've ever seen, bar none.
The players come from decidedly different backgrounds. Bassist Stéphane Lessard was only 16 years old when he was asked to join the team.
And I just started sitting in with bands at local bars around there. There was a lot of live music, and eventually I was asked by a friend of Dave's if I would be interested in trying out playing some of the songs of his. He had four songs. And
the famous four songs.
Exactly, yes. And he was going to be playing with Carter and Leroy, and I had known them from sitting in with gigs with them. And I left school and started traveling with this band, and basically decided that it was my schooling was going to be this band. And
so you went to your parents, who said, "What in the world are you doing? We thought you were going to go to college." And you said, "There's no better college for music than what I'm doing."
Yes.
Lessard's idol was the Rolls-Royce of bass players, jazzman Charles Mingus, who took the bass out of the rhythm section and made it a lead instrument.
He plays from, like, the gut. He's not frilly. He doesn't try and be too technical, but he is just a monster. He would like to set up the right foundations for the players who played on top of him.
Carter Beaufort, the son of a jazz trumpeter, had been playing and performing for decades before he joined the band. He, too, has a jazz great as an idol. Tony Williams, the West Coast wunderkind who helped drive the Miles Davis Quintet and who remains today one of the most influential drummers of all time.
The guy turned music around, actually. Turned music around for drummers. He said to other musicians through his drums, "Hey, look, we're not timekeepers anymore. We're gonna sing to you on these drums here. We're gonna say things through the drums." And that's what he did. And that turned so many other musicians around. It turned the whole world around, I think.
Violinist Boyd Tensley wanted to be a rock guitarist, but his school offered instruction in classical violin. So that's where he ended up.
You didn't see yourself in some symphonic orchestra?
No, not really at all.
Playing first violin?
Not really at all. You know, I had a lot of teachers who tried to sort of push me in that direction.
But does the training make a difference for you in what you're doing now?
It really does. You know, I mean, that classical training really did help get me to where I am now, you know.